Good evening. Welcome to Network X. I'm your host, Mike McCormick. Tonight we're going to be talking about the U.S. Navy's role in polluting Washington state through a couple different venues, one being the Bangor nuclear submarine base over on the Kitsap Peninsula, and the other just being through different ships and structures that the Navy uses around the state. To help us better understand what is going on with this, we have with us Glen Milner, who is with the Ground Zero Center for Nonviolent Action. Glen, thanks for coming back to the show.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
Let's start out and talk a bit about one of the Ground Zero Center folks who's been involved with it for several years now, Jackie Hudson. She is currently back in the state, but she just had a court case that didn't turn out real well.
Yeah, Jackie was involved in a nonviolent action in Colorado at a Minuteman III missile silo, and that was on October 6th, and she had been she was arrested then, and she's been in federal prison until April, till the end of April. She had a trial, and the judge found her guilty. Actually, she and two other Dominican nuns did the action. They took down a portion of fence and they spilled blood on top of the missile silo and symbolically pounded the top of the missile silo with hammers. The judge disallowed international law and a lot of defenses. He ruled in the Air Force case over and over again. She was found guilty by the jury, and she's will be sentenced on July 25th. She's facing up to 30 years in prison, and she's expecting to be in jail for 5 years anyway.
Now, her health isn't real good. She suffers from asthma, is that correct?
Yeah, she's 68 years old. As far as damage to the missile silo, the Air Force testified that at any time they could launch the missiles, so it really didn't damage the national defense. The actual damage to the fence was $750. And then through some various, what they ordered the people who repair the fence to do is to take the whole fence down, so it was over several thousand dollars, and it was enough to be a felony. So now for $750, she's looking at over 5 years in jail. And the two nuns are from Jonah House, which where the Berrigans are from, and they're facing even a little stiffer sentence because of their past records.
Right. And this seems to be a, in terms of the penalty that they are potentially incurring here, seems to be a pattern of late with stiffer penalties and harsher treatment for people that protest the government.
Yeah, it's been that way for members of Ground Zero, at least. In March, there was not demonstrators, they were just leafleters that were handing out leaflets, something they've done for 20 years, and they were arrested. Jay Inslee made an inquiry into the Navy in terms of why that was, and they said they needed greater security for the base. Another Ground Zero member, Ann Hall, was in jail in March also, and she spent five days in prison, and for a while she was in solitary confinement, and she was not given her medicines that she needed. Jean Buskin also, she may as well be a Ground Zero member. Jean Buskin was also in jail for several weeks and received similar treatment.
Mm-hmm. And these are people that, this isn't like a situation where these people are unknowns to the government. These are people who have been protesting for a long period of time. The government has, we assume files on all these people, very nonviolent, very peaceful people.
They're nonviolent people, yeah. It doesn't make sense to do that, to be so severe on these people.
Especially then prior to the recent change in climate with the Bush administration, for actions like these people hadn't really been penalized prior to this, is that correct?
Yeah, actually Jackie had done something similar and she wasn't penalized. On Mother's Day this year, we had a demonstration in Bangor where seven people were arrested, and they haven't pressed charges in several years for people who have done that. primarily because the juries in Kitsap County have found folks innocent. But we're not sure, the prosecutor hasn't told us yet whether they're going to press charges or not, so we're not sure there either.
Okay. Now, the whole name, the Ground Zero Center for Nonviolent Action, that comes from where?
Well, the center started in 1977, and its focus is on the Trident submarine base, and that's, you know, the Mother's Day action was at the Trident sub base. What we did on Mother's Day, as we have in the past, is block the highway going into the base.
Right, and that submarine base is the home of the Pacific Fleet for nuclear submarines.
That's right.
Probably, the, as far as we know, the largest depository of weapons of mass destruction on the West Coast.
Definitely on the West Coast. It's just about a fourth of the nuclear weapons of the United States are stationed there. And as far as the Middle East targets and Asian targets, it's become probably one of the most important nuclear bases for the U.S. military.
So, and as far as we know, at a minimum, there's 1,790 warheads.
Yeah, it's believed to be 1,760 nuclear warheads.
All right.
There, yeah.
Oh.
And also, I mean, a recent update is the W88, which is this larger Trident nuclear warhead. The 475-kiloton warhead has just recently been transferred to Bangor.
Okay. Now, and this is base with, you know, 1,700 some warheads of what, 150, 450 kilotons apiece, is just 20 miles from Seattle.
Yeah, or 50, actually it's 50, more like 15 miles, I think. It's very close to Seattle.
So if something happens there, we're going to directly feel it here.
What we have since March 2001, we filed a lawsuit against the Navy on the D5 missile upgrade, and the issue is, the primary issue is, if there's an accident on the base involving Trident missiles, due to the fact that there's warheads on top, it would spread plutonium across the Puget Sound area. It doesn't seem as likely there'd be a nuclear detonation, but there'd be a detonation of the rocket motor, which would spread plutonium. And, I mean, there's other issues involved in the lawsuit. I mean, the Navy is supposed to comply with Endangered Species Act and the National Environmental Policy Act, just like anyone else, and which they're not doing. But the primary focus is on the dangers that are on the base.
Right, and part of that comes from the reason that you're using this case is that the Navy doesn't bother letting people know when they're actually in the phase of loading these missiles, which can be somewhat dangerous, onto the boat. So you happen to be boating by in the area, then they have a little accident.
That's right. One Trident submarine, just the propellant on one submarine on the explosive handling wharf is equal to 3.7 million pounds of TNT. And so if there's an accident, the thought is if there's an accident, there could be a detonation of the boat, of the submarine, and then it would spread the nuclear material around. And it's true that the Navy, you know, one of the things that we discovered in getting information for the lawsuit was the Navy spent millions of dollars to move buildings outside of the explosive handling zone for the new Trident II or D5 missile, but they neglect to tell anyone on Hood Canal. In fact, the explosive handling zones go almost clear across Hood Canal, and so six days a month, we've been told that they are loading or unloading and handling missiles at the explosive handling wharf.
And yet none of these, even though the Navy is protecting their people, they're not bothering to tell anyone else that there's this danger occurring then.
Yeah, there's other dangers. I mean, there's shipping hazards with the rocket motors coming in and out of the base, and they don't want folks to know about that. I mean, there's nuclear warheads that are coming and going. They need to be checked and opened up.
Right.
So there's a lot of transport that folks don't know about.
But these are known, very real dangers that people perhaps should be alerted to, as compared to the possible dangers when they put, like, the country on code orange or whatever. Those are the possibility, generally pretty remote, of things happening there. So it just doesn't seem like a fair, on the one hand.
Yeah, it's crazy. I mean, here in Seattle, we had our terrorist exercise where the focus was a dirty bomb. Well, Bangor is the most enormous dirty bomb on the planet if there was an accident. And there's been, I mean, it's not just us pointing this out. The Navy's had its own studies that have pointed the problems with the D-5 missile. I mean, there's the way, the biggest problem is that the missile was made compacted and it's made with very volatile material to fit inside of the submarine. So it's the size constraints of the submarine that made them compact and make more volatile material inside the missile. And so it's the most hazardous nuclear warhead and missile system in the arsenal. And yeah, it just happens to be pretty close to us, 15 miles away.
Right. Maybe we can move on to talking about depleted uranium. There's a significant connection there. Back in January, the two local dailies had some articles about depleted uranium that actually had stemmed from work that you had done with the Freedom of Information Act. Can you tell us about that?
Yeah, I was doing research on Trident submarine navigation hazards. And you wouldn't think of this, but I mean, the submarines actually run into things. And I mean, there was two submarines, an attack sub and a Trident sub, that ran into each other off in New York several years ago. And so I was researching the hazards in the Puget Sound area. And one of the documents stated, and it was just a general navigation hazard announcement for ships to stay clear of this area off the Washington coast, because the USS Fife was firing depleted uranium rounds in the area. What it was they have is a gun. It's called a Phalanx gun, or the close-in weapon system, and it fires 20 millimeter rounds. And it's a system that's designed to take out incoming missiles or airplanes that are coming towards the ship. And it can fire, it just literally spits out bullets. It fires, depending on the model of the Phalanx gun, it can fire 3,000 rounds a minute, or it can fire 4,500 rounds a minute. So like roughly 80 rounds a second the thing fires out depleted uranium. And they were just happened to be shooting it in prime fishing waters. And that started a whole, I mean, that started the articles in the PI, and the Seattle Times covered it. And actually, that whole incident was covered, you know, all over the place. I mean, Italian newspapers and German papers, and it was all over.
Yeah, it was fairly, I mean, it's an interesting story in how you had to push just to get the newspapers to initially cover it, though.
Yeah, some of them, yeah, well, I mean, Larry Johnson, the PI, recognized this story right away. It did take some work to convince, you know, some of the papers.
All right.
Yeah.
So since then, what have you further discovered about that? I mean, that was a total surprise to suddenly come upon that, right?
Right, it was, yeah. Well, what I do on the Trident stuff is the same thing I did on depleted uranium. I file Freedom of Information Act requests. I don't know, I've like probably 30 or 40 of them filed to the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, to the Navy, to the Army, to find out as much information as I can. Mm-hmm. And actually what I found out is a lot of the information that the Navy was putting out in January to reporters turned out to be false. Well, some of the stuff is outlandish. Some of the stuff, this one rear admiral was telling people, and he actually wrote a letter to Jay Inslee and to McDermott, I should mention this, has got a bill to study depleted uranium that he's proposed. But in his letter to these congressmen, he stated that you can ingest or inhale depleted uranium. And I guess what we should talk about the fact that depleted uranium, for folks that don't know, is actually a radioactive projectile, or it's the projectile part of the bullet that's made out of DU, and it's got some very unique characteristics. What it does is pyrophoric, so it actually burns as it hits an object. It will actually burn as it goes through armor, and it releases a ceramic-like radioactive material. And this type of material will actually spread in the air, it spreads in the water. And the problem with it is if it's inhaled, it can get in the lungs, enters your body, and it's very carcinogenic. It's very toxic material. When they were firing DU into the water, it's a different issue in that the the DU rounds are not, they don't have this aerosol effect when it hits the armor. But it does break down in seawater, particularly seawater more than freshwater. And there hasn't been hardly any studies done on that. In some of the countries where we've used depleted uranium, there's concern where, you know, that the radioactive material would enter the water. And so this being prime fishing waters, yeah, a lot of the fishermen were upset. It was pretty crazy thing to do, actually.
Some of those countries where we have used it, and the U.S. has acknowledged that, is in Iraq, both the first time we were over there and the most recent time we were there. Sounds like we've used some in Afghanistan, and one of the documents you quoted was in Kosovo. They admitted using depleted uranium there that had some pretty hot elements in it.
Yeah. Well, the thing about depleted uranium is it's supposed to be U-238, is the isotope U-238. What they do, and the way it was always presented and understood, was they take the isotope U-235 out of the natural uranium for processing for either weapons or nuclear reactors. And the waste product left, which would be U-238, would be what they consider depleted uranium. I'm not sure where the term depleted actually came from. It's less radioactive than U-235. But what they've discovered recently, and the U.S. government's admitted this, is that a lot of the DU that's being used has come after the reactor process, so has waste material in it. It's what's called transuranics. It's heavier material. And some of that material is plutonium, which is far greater and far more toxic than U-235 or U-238. So it's a different material than what it's claimed to be.
Right. And as the government currently claims that depleted uranium is actually not really harmful to people, their own documents and their own actions that they take seem to contradict that.
Well, yeah, what they're saying, I mean, the great contradictions are, well, like I say, the Rear Admiral said you can inhale it or ingest it. But there's other documents where the Army has told its soldiers to be careful around depleted uranium or stay out of the tanks that have been hit with depleted uranium. And some of the documents I just got recently go back pretty far, where they know a lot more than what they've said of dangers to depleted uranium.
Well, for instance, talk about in the documents that you've dug up, the way that they go out of their way to, on the ships that carry depleted uranium, to make sure on the exterior of the ship that there's nothing that says there's depleted uranium here, whereas if you go below, they have, you know, these signs all over that clearly say this, you're dealing with toxic material, radioactive material.
Yeah. Well, yeah, as far as the shipping of depleted uranium, as far as in trucks or in rail cars, they have a special exemption that the Department of Transportation has given the Department of Defense. And what that says is they don't have to label the depleted uranium rounds as far as being radioactive. And as you say, on the ships, on the deck of the ship where some of the DU is stored, they have a numerical type of placard. And then underneath it, you know, inside the holds, is treated totally different. They have special signs, radioactive science, and they actually have instructions in terms of how to store it, the DU rounds in some of the magazines.
Do you have those quotes handy of from the documents that you had faxed to you, both the one about the three steps necessary to take? And if you don't have that handy, then we can skip by that.
But I do. Sorry.
But again, the way that the government's gone out of its way to make sure that, for instance, the word on trucks going down the highway, that the word radioactive has been removed from that, whereas they leave the word explosive on there. It sounded like they felt that having the two combined would just panic the public if they saw a truck going by them with that on there.
That's what they've said, yeah. You want me to read this?
Yeah, please, go ahead.
Well, I think the Department of Transportation just sent me this today. And they faxed it to me this morning. And actually, I got some documents from 1984 on shipping hazards and on hazards of DU in particular. And actually what the 1984 document is basically stating what a lot of activists that are concerned about depleted uranium are saying today. So they knew in 1984 a lot of this. As far as veterans of the first Persian Gulf War, they knew of the dangers. Mm-hmm. Pretty clearly.
The government did.
The government did.
The veterans did. Yeah, they kept it from the veterans.
But anyway, this 1986 document, and this is a letter from the Department of the Army to the Department of Transportation. And what it says is, our request, you want to read this?
Well, just that highlighted section that we talked about before.
Yeah, our request for exemption, and this exemption is the radioactive material on the side of the cars or whatever. Is based on the needs of the Department of Defense to ship DU munitions in a manner that does not draw attention to the fact that they contain a radioactive component. The ability to ship in this manner serves the best interests of the DOD without compromising the safety of the general public. And it goes on to say, there are three reasons for transporting DOD DU munitions without drawing public attention by placarding trucks or marking munition containers as radioactive. First, marking the outside of the DU munition containers as radioactive may cause friction with foreign governments when foreign nations handle DU munitions during shipping, loading, or unloading. Secondly, we do not want to generate unnecessary public concern about the radioactive risks associated with DU munitions. This is 1986. Thirdly, we do not want to raise public concerns by placarding trucks with the words radioactive and explosive, which they should be doing, since the combination of these two hazard class placards may be construed to mean that nuclear weapons are being shipped when this is simply not the case. Well, it's actually the case because it's not nuclear in the sense of a nuclear explosion, but they're radioactive weapons.
It's equivalent of dirty bombs.
It's a dirty bomb.
That we just did a drill for in South Seattle and paid $60 million
That's
for.
That's right. And in this document, too, it says that they've been shipping them since 1974, which this might be a pretty significant document because I don't know if anyone's seen this yet. I need to get it out to folks. But it says in here they've been shipping since 74.
On our highways, is your impression?
Well, yeah, on the highways.
Uh-huh.
And then it goes on to say, why they want to keep this quiet. And it's related to the issues at Bangor with the D5 missile upgrade. It seems as though the greater the risk to the general public, the more the U.S. government and the U.S. military want to keep it us from knowing about it. And it's nutty. The problem is if a truck or a train had an accident which would cause a fire, the only guy on the truck or the in a truck situation would be probably knocked out or injured, and the firefighters who respond to the fire would not know that there's radioactive material there until probably hours later.
Right.
And it goes on to say, what we know about depleted uranium, the stuff would aerosol. I mean, as the stuff explodes in the shape of, if it's bullets or the larger tank rounds or whatever it is, it would spread radioactive material all over. It would just be a radioactive plume, basically, as it's burning.
Now, and in addition, again, the U.S. government is currently saying, because of the coverage of depleted uranium use in Iraq, the stuff is harmless. Yet, again, the documents that you have from the government, from the Freedom of Information request, show that their own instructions say that they should be approaching situations where depleted uranium has been used very carefully, coming from an upwind position, making sure that they have their own separate breathing apparatus, things like that. It seems to totally contradict what the government is currently saying.
Yeah, it is. Well, I've gotten some later documents from the Army, and that's what they have definite instructions on depleted uranium, the soldiers, and they're mm-hmm. supposed to stay away from it, and only, specially trained, and people are supposed to go around, and they're supposed to have respirators and protection. And a big part of the Army, too, I think, is they're supposed to check stuff with meters, either guns they're firing, and a lot of it. And I don't know if they do or not, or how much of it the soldiers are actually told, but they definitely know that. And I think they're fairly upfront. The Army's fairly upfront, oddly enough, on those issues, at least they have been with me. While at the same time, you have the rear admirals who are stating you can ingest it and inhale it, and there's no problem.
All right. We are just about out of time. I want to get back to Jackie Hudson and make sure we get the contact info for contacting Judge Blackburn up. Jackie, of course, who has worked with you for years at the Ground Zero Center for Nonviolent Action and worked on these issues, these type of issues. So hopefully if we can get that CG up there for people to send a letter to the judge to encourage him to minimize the penalty for Jackie. And if not, let her off completely for the time she's served so far. Would that be a fair assessment?
Yeah, that would be fair. I mean, okay. if this severe a punishment for nonviolent protests, it seems it would encourage folks in the long run there to maybe start acting violently. I mean, there shouldn't be this severe punishment for what she did.
Okay. Well, with that, I think we are out of time, and would like to thank everyone for tuning in to another edition of Network X. We will be back next week, 7:30 p.m. on Cable Access Channel 77. Thanks for watching. America is essentially a dream.